people who I haven't met before. I think that was a pretty fun part.
Let's dig a little bit deeper. So why am I talking about the science of business or industry, university collaboration? Because as long as I remember all the 15 years we have been talking about it. So, quoting the old one, do it for three months. Don't try. So find out why are we still talking about it now? Why is it relevant now? Things are the fact that it's been 4 years in a row now. Estonians are actually less grumpy than they usually used to be. So maybe we don't have that. Maybe we can make enjoy them as well as they think. Why are we talking about the issues? Let's go to say the first one. Let's start with that definition in the world of the
team. So why are we talking about science to business? That's just a broad question. From my perspective,
you can only have that
I think it's hard to add some sort of some of those thoughts. I think it's a timing gap with the digital momentum point of view, and living at the moment is that now the time is to care. So I think this is a bit of a possibility for the future, but that now we can make things happen, and that's the thing that has talked about the topic and figuring out how to do it. So at the same time, the Nordic is second link, and I think it is really that it's not about a new topic anymore. I believe it's quite old and distributed Nordic already. And understanding that that's probably the only way forward to a sustainable way to build a better future. So I think this is a momentum point of view. I believe that we are having enough broad platform where we can build on. So I think someone has to be those early adopters and then frontrunners. And I believe that now we are moving to more that mainstream platform. I believe that the momentum is there.
Everyday life, some say that after the internet, there hasn't been any major technological breakthrough happening. Do you agree with this one, or do you see that there are something missing or something broken in the emergence of these advancements?
I think it's a better question than this financing part and decent capital is one of the topics that we did to be discussing. But actually, I think there are several things timing. Many of the VC venture capitalists say that the worst idea was and the better the outcome because nobody believes that this can be possible. And even in the ICT area, when we talk about enterprise solutions and service models. So, let's just take one for example. Timing, and where we are today, I think it was like a fire. Years ago when the internet or vegan started to come up and they demanded or wanted products that actually are the same as our plant-based products and how we can see one of the examples as being who have actually built the product, it's a food that it's a hamburger. So much time to actually get business behind science. So the science is not ready. And if you take Rico, for example, I don't know how important for you is the excellence, but actually how to move away from excellence and start just trying things out. So I don't know what's the easy answer, but definitely the resources part is what we're going to be I think just the complexity side, because there is not just one technology that we have to compete with our clients. There is a combination, and if we have like 1,000 startups in one target space, then there is a new one which brings a new market and helps scientific folks. So yeah.
Always,
like to answer the question you asked previously. I disagree with the fact that you said that they're not currently sort of big breaks in the right thing. It's the opposite. There are much more of the places, places, and we don't have the way things like the rent them.
I'm completely with you, by the way, because I also think that maybe it's not the big bang invention anymore. But if you think in terms of what, you know, small steps have been taken, and the platform on which these inventions come out today is much better than it used to be. You know, in the past, it was more concentrated, so the universities, the countries that had finance, etc. Nowadays, it's everywhere. It's from some parts to the last place. It's across all sectors, and I was thinking, you know, what to talk about here. It's a huge area. I mean, you can talk about innovation and how the science meets business and how the food meets business, how the business works in all kinds of together across the whole range of human life, you know, services and work. And I agree with you that I think if you look at the speed of development, then I think this planet, the speed of development has never been this climate yet. And I would also say that it's never been slower than if we go further. So I think it's an accelerated speed of progress.
And still come back to the excellent point for a moment, because by nature, both historians and things avoid people, they tend to be perfectionists. I'm not going to show my scientific advancement, my business idea, or anything to the others before it's, you know, really well chiseled out, looks beautiful, and so it can come. How do you see it in your day job? You meet the rest of the team to the university directly, and the technology transfer office. What things it in your company? And I suppose also where you see it in your investment to take proposals or companies don't deal with the projects. Is the excellence a problem or is it a prerequisite? How do you see it? Are we too perfectionist?
Yeah, I could add a part that I know about the discrimination within the branches. I've been in the three months and months of the story, I mean, depending on what you said again, of what I'm working with. But I see, and I believe this is very key, and because I've heard it from the previous question, that it's the ability to combine different technologies. And I think that is just excellent for the knowledge. So I can think like the mindset of skills that how you combine different components. And I believe now I see more and more people coming with quite early concepts, early on. So they will like to get reflections and so understanding. So the openness is definitely increasing. So there is not one single technology or one single right way forward. So I think there's multiple ways forward. And I see more now that you can have the better choices you have to succeed. So I believe both are really important. We have this premier mindset that we do, and the open mindset, and then excellence means that you can replicate it and you can do it again and again. That is another practice. So you need to go for it, but it's not to go one way or another way. And over the time, and maybe it's not so tech heavy or science heavy, my background, I've been 14 years, really early, startup ideas and a very young startup competition. And that is really the mindset shift I've seen. At the beginning, you know, that's my idea, I'm not going to present it. And that over the time, you see the people who are doing them, sharing them, they see the value that the first idea and the first concept is not the right one that you really succeeded. So, and more we have that type of example, then people become more brave and more open. And I think this is definitely the system. Everybody loves to see the concept of things, but I have to take this outlook for the people becoming more open and also more international and benevolent. That's another interesting dimension of this food. It's not only localized, but it's really internationalized.
It's also a mindset, I think, if you take scientists on one hand and then painters on the other hand, it's very different. And maybe the scientists, they try to be, you know, strike conversations and be perfect is the biggest thing in the world. Until there is a prototype of something that you can demonstrate to the investors that it actually works, somebody uses it. How do I know if I'm a scientist, you know, thinking and coming up with an idea that makes sense, solves the problem, and now I'm able to bring it to the market, and the development might take a long time until I get the until I get my article published in a scientific journal or magazine, etc. So I think that's the big gap. And I would also say that it depends on where this invention comes out. You know, one thing is the scientist and the universities, the other thing is the R&D that comes to research and development. We find some law that about 15% of all of the financing estimate is to R&D. Most of it is with a lot of the companies. We finance software, coming up with IT solutions, we finance demand, for instance, a Danish company doing a hearing aid. And so on. So they all lead us, at least in the region, in their own field. But the bigger problem is that the startups, where do they get them? I have some things that they say. Startups are not going to be a startup. Not for them. They are to be financed by other means, or equity, first of all. And the equity would come from various different sources, depends on where you are in the development. The bottom one is the SSS, or the Friends Groups of Finance. And then you might have a business angel, and you might have a piece of capital, and then you have climate technology, and then by that time you can become something that can happen.
Answering the question about this excellent mindset, do you use or does it hinder commercializing the university from this perspective? The biology of dealing side, do you see that the next disaster? Of course, because researchers have to be driving to excellence. They are competing with the world's brightest minds in their field and they are consulting. So, in that kind of mindset, it's easy to see that fall into this kind of perception that okay, my thing is only small, it hardly competes with the other great minds. So that's something that we have to work on. Also, that we have been working on the university is that to lower the threshold for the researchers and academics to see that it can have an impact already. How did they come about? So a lot of this kind of teaching or educating them is bringing this idea of experimenting. But also with the commercial models, not only with the research topics.
So we have actually touched on several different issues. I'd like to have a couple of them one by one. One is the change part, which is following actually from your last talk about the implementation of teaching and education, and I would like to ask Mike, do we have a kind of implementation problem in the science and business field? Do we need to do that? Is the science field that science is perceived as hard, difficult, complex, it's not for you, unless you're a PhD, you won't understand it. Do we have an issue there as well? Somehow
imperceivable to different parts. I think that's so, because there are different circles and different communities, and it's like never ending. And so, when you're trying a new community, and first trying to understand the language that they are speaking. So to really understand what's so important for anyone doesn't always seem like the reference of some bankers and scientists are different. Success is different for them. So the really almost anyone in the system, there has been a lot of debate on some people and things that maybe introducing to scientists, entrepreneurial models is the right way, but we should take business people and introduce them to scientists to find the right tools. So it's a basic topic and to really change this. Some parts people and some success stories and find.
Either men do not find that successful, if they don't have a vocabulary for emotions, especially if they're stressful or sad. So, can we bring this over to the field that the scientists don't have the bankers' vocabulary, that they need to be taught it, and vice versa? Or maybe the bankers do have the scientists' vocabulary. In order to get this early funding, the project very early phase is not bankable, so they need to get the tools behind or need to get the business center behind the why should one invest if he doesn't understand what it's about. So why should I invest if I don't understand who the issue of the story is still going to play this?
I think we need to take it away from the level of an individual side to the level of kind of a union, university, corporate. These are the entities you can actually work with and give them money. They know better than you in the banking office how to use it best. And of course, not every attempt is successful and not every invention is actually something that works. But it's more of a kind of a try, test, fail, try, test, fail, and give you the try, test, and succeed.
€10 billion is invested each year in projects in Europe. It's 60 billion is the whole amount. So now we can see that actually investors are looking into that, but these teams are a bit different. And they need to have a bit different mindset and debate what's in the recent hours is balanced the actual vision model.
In order to this have happened, so at least we think that it has happened, that we academic that story
10 years ago, it seemed that our market seemed like that HFS money was the only money for the early stage entrepreneurs, but now it's plenty. But there have been discussions during institutional changes that have made it possible. The past few years, several people have focused.
I just wanted to comment that the seminar at Nordic campus, where the government has been doing an increased and then there was Germany. And there was this day, they were fully taken yesterday, they were able to perform as well as a week, and then there was some sort of report that those companies and rent out the money comes from big firms, not just the way they can go to the service. It's also more what I assume.
Let's not lower our flag too much. I think given that this is the Nordic area, the Nordic countries have actually been quite good. Not only the country, but I'm sure the city of America.
And if you look at the statistics, they are more inclusive, and I think it's Finland and Norway.
Your life surely must be a therapist, right? So what are the aspects of your work you wish people knew that your life is actually not a therapist?
I work for an IFI, which is an international financial institution owned by eight governments, in case of the Nordic Investment Bank, and my previous career over a quarter of a century was in EBRD, which is the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development, also owned by governments, 72 at the moment. So it's not fairy tale in the sense how you need to, you know, make sure that your governance stays market-based commercially. And you're never going to get paid with these things if that's what becomes the fairy tale to some of the other ones. The difference to with the IFI funds is that they're all mandate-driven institutions, and that actually is very important. On every project, the bank assess not just look, is this profitable or not, but they also assess, does this fit on the mandate? You know, does this promote productivity in a given country, in a given economic sector, or to give it to the consumer? Is this environmentally friendly? You know, does this mitigate climate change? I mean, these are the good things, I think, which come through, and that's a way, in fact, for the governments to channel money. They have created an institution, it's not under political influence from one country, and therefore has nothing to do with the political election cycle where things can change, you know, from one to the other overnight. But there is an institution that carries on based on its mandate and tries to be good and not just make money.
Is there a separate session?
We have like still 40 minutes to go.
And I understand what they're doing at the same time. So, but I think maybe few components that I believe that I've seen that I've worked a couple of times. First of all, I think you need the top management support. Whatever you want to achieve, you need the mandate. And you need to have a principal position that you want to be in the blessing of something. So you can work towards the place connection to bottom up and top down. I think you need to put top support into play. And second, moving based on my experience, is having critical mass of success stories. And having to tell your doctor, giving the space that the freedom tend to move and to do what they believe is the best for the future. So, and I think it's kind of that type of like conservative organization. I believe that people have succeeded by doing how they expect it to be done. So, and I think this is a lot of professionals, a lot of knowledge, and that's just really necessary. And at the same time, I think you are failing to lose your reputation if you do these things. So how you can build an environment when the professionals with the best knowledge can be in the neutral space. So they can go an experiment. They can do things differently based on the rhetorical knowledge. That's the first step. At the same time, collaborate with those beginners who don't have a background from the past. Combining the type of teams, and even I think in our discussion, we're talking about the funding too much. I believe we have to talk more about teams or the people and the mindset. So this is really the fundamental, that to build the space and to build the framework, how you can work together with the people from different backgrounds as a small team, independently. And I believe that, as Steve Blank has said about that, in each organization there is those innovators. But in most of them, those are really, really professional how they're fighting themselves. So because all the key players and metrics doesn't support their ability to execute, but they really believe what's good. So I think this is the part where you build the environment, you have a space where they can experiment, build the first success story, show it the way, and I think then it's really starting to happen. And the second, I think it's also really important from organizational design point of view that never don't try to centralize the innovation or the building to the future activity. It has to be centralized. It has to be close to the real business, real life experiences, and it's part of real everyday business. It's not separate avenues. So I think you have to combine today, present and the future in the same time, and then I think you can build systematically further. So I think those are maybe the elements of the change that I believe which has been so far with the bank background and with the political background and has been successfully starting point, but it's a long journey.
Okay. I meanwhile encourage the audience, offline audience, to take rain cover. It's okay, you don't need to get wet. If you have any kind of questions, you can wave or talk with another person. And as I promised in the discussion invitation, that everybody can share their opinions.
Come closer here.
Yes. There is no glass wall or ceiling between us. Yeah, there is even room in the panelist couch. If you don't find a spot, that I see a couple of people who are well worthy of the spot alongside the panelists.
Maybe just to have in Mark's ideas, I think it's really, really important to encourage people and initiatives, because I think one of the worst things to do to starting entrepreneur is just to say how bad the idea is. Because it's like a have the open mind and try to understand what actually you can do. So it can be this kind of neutral spaces to be an actually present what you're thinking, because you don't know for sure that it works, but you have the idea. And for scientists, my previous point was the excellence part, I understand that it's really, really important in their work to do everything the right, to analyze, to come to conclusion, to double check the evidence. Okay, so for them to talk about their ideas in the good stages, because I think there's like a part B and I think most these communities.
I think we're not still talking about the dialogue between, you know, the creatives and the users perspective and the scientists and the businesses. And I think you need to both sides have value to provide. And it's important to encourage them. And for instance, my previous employer had something just called business supplies and services, which media be provided, and essentially they put together the consultancy service where you put together the beauty prices and you figure out what is the thing. Is it innovation? Is it better management quality audit system or marketing system? And then it's the way to set the framework and you say, okay, that's what the market has provided. See how the potential provider is. And these could be scientists. These could be universities. These could be consultants. And then in the end, EBRD paid 50% or up to 50% of the total cost. Which is also a way to kind of, you know, promote, put the money where it actually promotes the company.
Yes, but I have that cloud as well, but sometimes it is the university because it's a business perspective, and there is different people, that's for sure, and that's kind of innovative subscription. But I think what we have seen also in some cases when we hire the third or the fourth partner, the dialogue becomes much, much more predictable to the one that we did is to be one of the founders of the Congo, which is a collaboration and innovation and building collaboration models between different corporates as well. So it means that when you have a couple of corporates, even from different industry backgrounds, and having the university knowledge and having the same advisory practices, so you build absolutely more neutral platform. So a startup layer, it takes time until you get the same understanding and so on. But when you find the new type of business models, which is combining from multiple types of practices, then it's much more balanced further on. So I think not the university versus the corporate. Having a couple of concepts as well to solve some specific topics is having the broader industry engaged. And I think sometimes it may be necessary, but I think always it could be plan B, that you have some more neutral advisory or facilitator. So if business or scientist takes lead, it doesn't always come out with the best solution, but when you have this facilitator option as well, makes it up, then I think you get some early forwarding plans before things become too complicated and then the way back is too long to become more sort of collaborative environment. So it's a very big environment that you can have to make it necessary.
Okay, also want to answer to the main question that you said that you set up this new product platform, which is a facilitator.
I think that this, what I'd like to do is use that prevention to be the one that's facilitated, for example, one is about renewal ideas, but also some partners with the civil rhetoric and so on, and linking to infrastructure. It is not one single point that I think is the responsibility, it's just this brave people who say, yes, I want to start, and you didn't know how the future looked like, but you're just setting up, stepping out from your home for the goal for the point, and you started to get moving, I think, and on the way you will find these people. Having more entrepreneurial minds that those open and brave people who started to get moving, so that if you can't think of it, that's it, we need to speak more, and we need to know each other more.
I can answer
a lot of
this
question.
I'm reading different research, different science, and taking the background from the startup ecosystem. We need to understand that the company or the person wants to start the business in the sector. They need different collaborators. It's not only the university, and it's not only a big corporation, but they need simple services, and they don't even know what they need. So the ecosystem thinking, and I think everything will follow there, but just to understand themselves that they want to be entrepreneurs, because this is also the question. And when I talk about the science and scientific people, do they understand that they are one part of a bigger team and what kind of team they are? So definitely the question, I think, that all of us seeking to do something, but then the question goes back to the mandate. What is our mandate and what is our organization? So for me, like a governmental organization or an ecosystem, capital market development, or like a perspective, definitely the market goes to that direction, and we need to try to sit around how to build the resources of these entrepreneurs, because these are a bit different than others.
This is like my question. Well, it's a good question, but I think it's a right to the other. You want to have children, then you can really also say that now you need your choice and walk the walk. This is a bit of a different topic, but the one that we have seen, especially here, that we have been researching, but businessmen, one thing that I've been with myself is the perfect feeding us. Once we do the stress, the result is not always favorable. I want to ask from Andrea also that from your legal team types, you have seen the weak plan and target. The Ukraine, the Kazakhstan, following again the changes. Have you seen or have you yourself inspired and enabled this change that you have seen? All the years, the 4 or 5 years of the work, but actually this is in a big place, the change took place. Have you managed to put the finger on it and say that yes, this is the right thing that we can do about it?
Well, this is something we have, of course, looked at throughout the investment process for many years. And you often find out that you actually made a difference at the enterprise level. You know, at the enterprise level, you can actually pinpoint that this is what they have before, this is what they have learned, and that's much better. What is difficult is to kind of go back and say that we have transformed the country. And this is something that I think we have basically not stuck. We have stuck for reasons well beyond the science and the business. But it is more of the problem between the business and the politics and that kind of things today. But at the enterprise level, absolutely. Many new ideas, many new inventions have been financed, have been created, success. And when you do something, they are competitors, so you look for a good idea. Then you get to pull in your network of governments and investing companies and the multiplier effect.
Following on that one, because actually we are offering Estonia as a country that we have. If you would give your country, what would you do with it? And now you're saying that, you know, in a country level, things get messy and stuck, but maybe we should also understand another country. But leaving that food for thought for other people who might be listening to us, perhaps online. Very good, Marisa, the I've seen the evolution of Estonian ecosystem over 10 years now. What would you like to see happen in the next 5 years? What have you seen in this current community?
I think understanding a new sustainable world and when you go through some sustainability and of course and then I'm talking about 3 P's, it's like perfect people and talent. And many of us see the impact as one of the drivers and we see that when you talk about science or deep tech and lead to business, it's like a horizontal field in the future. In a way, a universal thing. It's not something specific, but we can talk about fintech, we can talk about quantum technologies, we can talk about advanced materials, whatever it is. So I think startups and the startup ecosystem, which is currently booming and understanding how to build a business, how to scale up, and what that customer needs is a really cool place to start building up the scientific ecosystem in the world because these people are already and just a little bit along the way or the way the former employees are personalized wise, right, whatever they are thinking about and doing investment platforms, whatever things you can do. So I see that time has not been any time sooner and also the trust Estonia as a trademark inside venture and startup ecosystem guys, it's like 10 extra points when they look to the companies.
I think totally supportive of my ecosystem discussion here. I think also beyond that, you need to really be able to make it visible beyond Estonia, beyond the whole region, because that is what attracts you. You need to have bright people to not just don't need to be local nationals. But I think it's important to mix in different views, different cultures, different ideas, different levels of willingness to respect, etc. And bring in human capital is the biggest intangible asset. I agree on that a lot, but I want to usually don't rely on policies or don't really care about the entrepreneurs who are sectors and the context that you work in, but this is something that I really want to do with the politics and the policies take to bring a broad and circulating perspective on how to be one part in the circle and decrease the impact and how can it actually be easier for the right mind to set up the right.
Okay. I'm not going fast on that on how to define the right. That could lead us to another long discussion. But I do have a similarly long question to Mark, because it seems that I have like the best and most vague and honest question to Mark. So how are you able to build this working and plastic partnerships? In this human capital, especially considering the whole Nordic scene in a global context, we are more likely to come. So how are we able to build these partnerships?
Yes, I think to Daryl and you take some to the mind. First of all, I think it's we can replicate some other success stories. I think when we're talking about people, not deep tech rather like the software, the service, the business, examples, what we have manifested as a single thing to build here in Estonia, combining people from different backgrounds and so on. I think I really believe that we can replicate this very sort of a deep tech environment. And I think it means that even we're by designing, and I think when we have this from the day one global mindset, whatever we think, we start to attract the mechanism. And it is the natural logic that talent attracts talent. So we need to be able to physical myself that individual is starting to move, and it's going further, and you're having this global mindset from the market point of view, and also, I believe that is also from the past that physically we have to be here all together all the time. That's another like an environmental system of organization, right? So when the mission drives people together, they do something together, they don't have to be here physically in the right part of one thing, even in the students. But they have to be engaged to do the kind of the mission that we do. So those companies and the new businesses or industries that we're building here, they have to be enough meaningful for enough broad and attractive audience where we can sell it into the second years. All the rest of the world should know us, but we do, yeah, otherwise it doesn't make sense. So we have to be able to do the selling the stories and show this example. I believe this is one of the ways how to build a global community. And the second I think it is that yes, we are 1.3 million, we are really small, but in the small scale we can be really flexible. We can shift, change, design differently, and learn really fast. And I think this is the one of the advantages that we have here. So it means that in the Nordic context, I believe when we have more or less the same culture and understanding and background, this is really good place to be and to collaborate. So we can be faster, we can be faster learners, and I think to try out in small scale, that we can do as a country. So I think it is one really opportunity that we can see. Here you can make things happen at the one country level, and then I think if it works, it's a bit of border scale, we can replicate further on. I think this is like the environment from the perspective that secondly, I believe, really attractive by the proposition that we can formally together and also bringing in this deep tech dimension, because I think we're so far we have been more like to the business, I can see the point of view successful, but I think we can really build the bridge between those two categories.
I think one of the important things there is to think about not only the local ecosystem, but more important, because if you talk about different verticals, then we don't have big farmers here in Estonia. I think it's like 6,000 companies who employ more than 250 people or something like that. So our economy is really, really strong. Even if you get something, you don't have the right conditions. So the Nordic dimension here is really, really important. And I think if we talk about different industries and areas also inside of the ecosystem today, it's already at least regional, so European level. We are talking about we need to put effort to handle this because Europe is 27 different markets and to really have the right conditions. So to have this in mind as well, because I think one of the conclusions made to look at Estonia's startup ecosystem is too local, and now the question is how to be more visible on the European level and find the right connections to offer the right services.
Signing up for this value-based mission that we describe. But, we want to make the world better sustainable in place. Are we still then saying that, okay, we keep them in, we don't allow you to leave, but we are willing to take people in, but we are not willing to give them away? So are we ready to face them? As I say, there are 27 countries in the deep markets in the EU. The people, our people, who don't keep them in, what will happen to stay?
I think this point was that 5-7 years ago, when startups were in a way mystic creatures, nobody knew about it, and they were like, some balloons and pizza and and it was like, how can we be just behind? And then they they are moving the way, they are taking the investments from outside. And when Vice made IPO, and they were proud to say that thousands of Vice employees work here in Estonia. So in a way, we need to understand the globalization and the risks, but I think this is the reality. In today's pandemic world, do we need the people here present in Estonia? What is the future of work? Which is,
I agree.
I see it more as a success than a big thing. The thing is, there are thousands of big companies that are doing it. Another aspect is also that we need to, when we talk about South people, entrepreneurs, they're not all young people. Gradually they have families. And that kind of support network then to be created that you can actually be a young parent. The part of this is that you can put your kids in the classroom school, which is really not the level that is acceptable. So these type of things are all essential in this kind of controversy, whether or not people come or go. The good examples that I enjoy especially are the ones that you are surprised about. So we have visitors who have been very much working on the academic area. Thank you.
Thank you. All the time for the biggest focus. I like the fact that the food tech, one of the biggest problems globally nowadays is very much the resolution of very much driven by science and so on. Yeah, so not naming names, but the best, from my personal experience, is the best cases of the ones that you actually described, that this kind of basic research and having it again part of the conference. They don't have to be the CEO, they don't have to be the basic entrepreneur type, but they're actually the most important part of the culture.
Yes, and one example that I would like to share is that from the university is the virus infection by spreading to the main series. And I think this is a good example when we're talking about the limited bias, when the market need is there and when researchers combining together researchers and entrepreneurs. So it's a two university, and human vehicle, and as well two companies, entrepreneurs. So they combine is one option. And time to market from opportunity, as first meeting until the product was launched for 4 months. So that's another great example. So it's not new invention as a technology point of view, but it's already research that they're finding in the university, but applying in the right time, in the right context, in the right position, and really succeeding. So I think this is another good example, I believe, that we need them more. And maybe another related to point is that all the units have to reinvent everything which has been never been before. So it's all about applying the right combination of technology that's already prepared in the research lab and the engineering work. This, I believe, is really good example and the gratitude for all of us.
That's a good point. 90% of the knowledge exists already. That in every session, that's the point that is supposed to be not only session, we have 90% of things we knew already, just the extra 10% value that you might find if you are working. So, but do you have any other questions? I also remember one next to do example from the university So he came back to Finland, established the company, and after a few years made an IPO in the London Stock Exchange. At that time, in Finland, the perspective of scientists didn't have a company because, you know, business was something different. And in the US, like, it was the complete other way around. But there, like, every aspect of the scientists had a company. So this is like the mindset and cultural part. I enjoyed the growth in the startup as well. But we are closing, nearing to the close of our session, so any final thoughts, and I would like to ask you to formulate it in a form of four questions, what can our audience and what can we do to improve the situation, to make the life better. So I'll give you a little bit,
one of the questions that I asked about how difficult it is, or how difficult it is, scientists and scientists want our society, and it can offer more opportunities for business than we can imagine. So, scientists are looking for new technologies that have been coming out of laboratories. Trying to find a common language to really assess the potential, because maybe there is something for you, and definitely not only science, everything is not commercialism, but next to this. So, the new entrepreneurial community inside of the university is happen to them.
Talk to a scientist like he's a human being, he or she's a human being, because often they refer to the scientist like he's conducting experiments on them, instead of a zoo, like, you know, the scientists see white coats and everything that, you know, happen. So let's treat them as human beings. Something you might come up with.
I would suggest that we shouldn't see the science of business as two different dimensions. The scientists depending on the science of the world. I think they're increasingly integrated. So the companies and the large companies who are working with the scientists to work for them, so the scientists become employees, so the laboratories that used to be at the university and then at the company. And the R&D or the research and development basically it's a volume business. You know, the more you pour into it, money wise, resource wise, the higher the likelihood that something good comes out of it. And the larger companies have
full social media researchers to say that I have researched it. I don't know. Maybe slightly more curious than you know, really doing that. So,
yes, I truly believe that we need more entrepreneurs. And I think they might be entrepreneurs, they might be faster than entrepreneurial minds. I think it doesn't have to be like a business. You have to be cool with them, but the definition of the means that you are working in them. So you have to know what is your voice, what they know, and what they don't know, and who else can compliment me. And so you can compensate if you are missing your competence. And the same thing you mentioned also that there are two leaders. I think this is one of the most important things. They may be also so much of a collaboration. I think to understand it, that to treat your ego, being a team and feeling the output together with the right people, you can achieve much more. So I think this is really the mindset and probably the easy key for us for success. You're in a single, in your own ego, and doing the assessment that has to tell you the opportunity for getting great businesses. But then it depends on the relationships. That's the way I think that's the only way to become successful and get it bigger and more and more effective.
Excellent. I did promise that I would ask you this question, but I'm leaving at the very end, and I still ask because I have you were also like leading a relatively few fights, well recognized position, probably in a happy life. And then you decided to go to academia. But why?
I'm always willing to learn, so I think you, that's the first reason. I think I'd like to learn, and when I'm altogether with sort of smart people around me, probably I'll learn something faster and more, and I can learn still. But I think that's one part. The second thing I believe that when really being in the well-matured companies, when you're doing events and under the same side of the environment, I think you can do incremental innovation. So by definition, large corporates are designed in a way to get the wealth that they have once created. So you cannot make too radical moves. I believe that moving more to being and moving more early stage, I think there is much more new opportunities, and then you can do much more relevant and relevant from the new dimensions. But I am not so many more, so much in under the bank. So there's a lot of collaboration from this organization and so on. But I think this is really the second way. Motivated me to learn and to really to impact point of view. I believe from that position and that development, the impact the longer is probably broader. I believe that the only thing that I mentioned is that it can deliver. This is the proof of the system necessary to be driving and have a good belief that it can do the right things, but I think there are more opportunities and bigger business with the concept. I have used the spectrum rebel and even on paper in my home, my own old homework is sort of balancing the spectrum rebel. I think this is really the success principle in the corporate world. How you do not rebel but do not respect it. But I believe, yes, I think, I think yes, there is more space in the corporate world.
I'm very much a simple way to respond to your question. It's the mark is a leading example. The bank is a no longer
so understood when he said that, you know, I like to surround myself with smart people and I have to leave from the bank. So,
but I decided to learn new things from smart people.
don't come out with them.
No, it's, you know, that we are still living in a modern business place. We always have to cut something out of the context and put it so that it can be quoted. Not Mark said that bankers are stupid or something like that, but that makes the headlines, so we get to the evening news. So thank you to the panelists, thank you to the brave audience who braved the weather, braved our not-so-easy discussion, and thank you for the picture, thank you for the Nordic Concept Ministries for having us. Now is like the final time to share your final thoughts. Perhaps the same churches, we didn't discuss religion, but speak now or be silent forever. So now is your chance. And enjoy the banquet, the beautiful ceremony of the Arvamusfestivalil. Thank you very much.
Thank you.